today I want to show you guys some patterns and some concepts because, quite honestly, people in this class and also on the internet have been asking me over and over and over again, and I've sort of been trying to answer each of them individually, but they've been asking me the question, what's a base? And for people who've been playing Go for a while, like, that's kind of a weird question because we don't think about it as much. It's just sort of more of our, you know, something we just innately do and have like this internal connection with. But if you're a new player or even an intermediate player who's been playing for a while, you may not have put those connections together. I am video recording it too, you know.
I'm just proving I'm here.
Okay. Just proving you're here. All right, yeah. Perfect. So specifically, the base formation I want to look at today is the two-space base, which is perhaps one of the most... two-space base. Which is perhaps one of the most sort of famous base formations. We have lots of different base formations. This is a base formation. Why, what makes this one stone a base?
Wall.
It's a wall. It's not a wall. It's not
the wall of the board. The edge of the board is as good as a wall.
Okay, so we can actually utilize the edge of the board. But what are the other characteristics? Like this, I'm saying this type of formation has characteristics to it that make it a base.
Well, it's alive.
It's not dead. That's good. Because this is also a base. Right, but this is very different than this. And you know what else? This is also a base.
Has space underneath it where you could live.
It has space underneath it to live. And what do you mean by live?
Two eyes.
Yeah, specifically it has potential for making eyes. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about stones that are harder to attack because there's eye power. So that's really the key idea when we're talking about these bases. We're talking about, you know, stones that can't be removed their eye space and or have friends nearby that help them connect and live. So there's lots of different base formations, right? And you know, we call this one the Shamari. There's a large Shamari. We can even play High Shamari. Technically, that's a base. It's a very ambitious base. Really, really ambitious base. I mean, lots of different shapes here will make something that I would feel comfortable calling a base. But you might find that in your game, let's say, let's give black the corner, because black always has the corner. White approaches a black stone. What does black start to do, normally? Run away. I don't want you to think of it as running away.
Oh.
I want you to think of it as building a base.
Oh.
Okay?
Building a base somewhere else.
Building a base.
Somewhere else.
Good. All right, what is white doing here?
Pushing in.
Also making a
also
base.
Also actually building a base. Yeah. That's actually the real meaning of this move. Yep. Saying, oh, by the way, hey, there's this potential for base making in the corner. Can I have some? In this case, let's say black says, no, you cannot. Or all you get is what you get. And white usually comes back here and makes a base over here. And this is a very, very common, basic sort of opening Joseki. I'm sure most of you guys have seen this or something like it out there before. But really, what did both players get out of this?
A little security.
A base. I'm looking for the word is a base, right?
It's always a base.
They both got bases. Meaning that neither of these stones, or these groups, I should say at this point, can really be severely attacked. Now, later on, if white has a stone here, and black does something else, it turns out white can take away black's base, right? This is no longer a very solid base. If black really wanted a base here, black should have responded to this move.
Really?
But because black didn't, here's one sequence that is pretty terrifying if you've never seen it before. And depending on what black does here, if black just connects, let's say we just play the crudest variation possible. My question is, does black have room to make two eyes now? Like, no, this is not a good base. Okay? So it's really funny, right? Because in Go, we can go very, very quickly from having a pretty solid base. Oops, there, to having no base. Right, that's pretty amazing, actually. Right?
So that's why still on 17-2, they all be different for a base.
Well, yeah, if white plays here.
Yeah, yeah. But
you have a base again.
Yeah, yeah. But given that there was an approach on the bottom, black, yeah, given that white got that there for black to allow the approach on the top,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Now we don't really have a base.
It took three moves for him to be, white moves for him to be the base.
Yeah, this is true. This took a lot of work. This took a lot of effort for white. But there is potential there. And maybe this move did something over here. Right? Maybe this move when white played this did something over here. So white might be able to actually find time to get all these moves in and take away the base. Like, go is complicated, right? This is not the only thing going on the board. So sometimes you think you have a base, but then your opponent splits you, and all of a sudden you realize that the two bases you thought you had are both under attack simultaneously. And that's a problem.
So that stone on the 12th line there, that bottom white stone.
12, oh, this one. Yes.
Yeah, I don't know how.
Yeah, this one.
8th line,
yeah.
Okay. I mean, obviously, one of the potential is that it can connect out to that stone. But if that stone weren't there, would they still be able to take away the base, or would it just...
No, because white's place here makes a bigger base over here. At this point, so are you asking, like, okay, let's say white plays this first?
Yeah.
So this is very small, right?
Yeah.
Black extends
the
base.
No, but if you didn't have the black stone, white still would make that invasion without being able to connect out.
Oh, which black stone? I'm sorry.
It's just like this.
Okay, yep.
But now white tries that same invasion.
Inside.
Oh, here.
Yeah.
You know, this is more complicated.
Actually...
Normally white would never play this. This is very strange.
Okay.
Because if we play this move first, we still know that black doesn't have a base. So it's like we're trying to pop out the base before black has a base. And in this case, if white plays here, black could still just come over here.
I see.
I mean, black's, you haven't taken away the possibility of black expanding his base.
Okay.
You know, it's sort of like trying... This is like white trying to capture a greased pig. You can't... You got to get it in a small, confined area first, and then hug it. I'm not a cowboy. Is that what it is? Is this how it works? Something with a pig and like a can of butter, right?
Sounds good.
Get a small, confined area and whack on the head.
Yeah. So this is premature. And in fact, if we play the same type of variation, even though black's not really going to have a base, the thing is, neither is white. So this is actually a really big problem for white. We might even be able to just hunt it, or if we don't, we can just play this again. And, you know, even though black stones don't technically have eye space, there are so many of them, like it has so many liberties, and it has so much room to run, there's no need for a base. Our stones are strong enough without.
Well, I don't know why you can't call that a base.
Well, you can call
thickness,
it a base. It's not a base.
Thickness of base.
Sure. We can call this a base if you like. So, is that kind of?
Mm-hmm.
It's cool. But I'm going to scroll backwards a little bit. And go back to this formation. Similarly, black has a stone here. This actually puts a lot more pressure on this base as well. So, there are evil things that black can do to this group of stones as well, that are pretty terrifying. So just because you played the Joseki doesn't mean you never, and you have a base, doesn't mean you never need to think about it again, right? Whenever your base becomes, we'll say surrounded, you know, or at least it has some pressure on both sides, you need to actually take your next move very, very carefully.
Well, right. This is sort of like it's the base coming into being is not quite there yet. It's potential.
I would feel comfortable saying it's not into being. It has a base.
Well,
and the reason this has a base,
yeah,
definitively, is because it alternates white and black turns, right?
Yeah.
So if white takes away this way, we just extend the base this way. We still have a base. If white plays this way, we extend this way. We still have a base. If black plays
but
over
it's,
here?
It's, but the base, you know, if you take that last black stone, but in this case here, this base is kind of conditional. If white approaches on one side, you're going to pop out the other side. Is it kind of a conditional thing? No?
All right, goes like water.
If you plug one hole.
I'm saying that this group has a base,
yeah,
in the same way that I say these two stones are connected.
Yeah.
Do you think, do you believe that these two stones are connected? I mean, if white tries to separate them.
But that's what I'm saying, it's conditional if you do it with two stones in there. Yeah.
Yeah, so white needs two moves, right, in order to take away the base.
Yeah. So in that case, you're not connected because you didn't respond.
You didn't respond, right? So, I mean, I would say, John, if you believe that these two stones are connected.
Potentially.
Okay.
Whatever, this one.
All right, I think this is semantics. I think for you, if it makes you feel better with the universe to say that this only has the potential of a base. That's fine, but for me, that is the definition of a base, right? Is that it has the potential for I space, right? It's not going to be easily beaten. Okay, so that's my definition of a base. I don't need to literally see the two I's. The same way I see this as being connected, even though there's no literal stone connecting. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. We're all on the same postmodern philosophical bent now.
Closer, yeah.
Perfect. All right, I want to show you a few patterns, actually. And I'm gonna start with one of this, Joseki. We're gonna go to some more basic shapes. But I'm gonna start with this one because this is such a well-known Joseki and something that you're very likely to encounter in your games. Has almost everyone here played this Joseki at least once ever? No? A couple new people? Not so much. Well, okay. Maybe? Throw your hands up? Good. Alright, let's hear us go back to the beginning. A lot of newer people tonight. 4-4? You guys have played this move. How many people have played this move in their game? Good. How many people have played this move in their game? Good. White approaches you. There's a lot of different things you can do, right? One of the ideas is you can take away white space, right? That's a move. We can say, you know what? We're just going to have this little, like, turf war. I'm just going to build, and you're going to build, and we're all going to be happy. Or we can say, I'm going to go build a base over here, and I'll let you build a base over there. And this is perhaps even most common still, even at professional play. Like, this is still seen as one of the strongest moves. It looks very strange, but it turns out it's really nice. White asks for a little bit more. Black plays the corner. Black doesn't need to play this. At this point, we could still come back here and take away white space. Like, we could. There's other variations, okay? But this is the simplest that I want to talk about, and white comes here. Very, very common. And in fact, if you were here last week, we actually saw this Joseki in the Li Cheng Ho game when he won his first international tournament, right? Game 5 of the finals, right? This is what they freaking did in the left corner, right? It's like beginner Joseki, like level 1, like your introduction to pattern, to corner patterns. Okay, I'm going to show you a couple patterns, the first of which is one that you're actually likely to see a lot after you play this Joseki. And it happens when... So black has something like, let's put it this way. Black has something like this, and maybe white has a bunch of stones over here. In this case, black isn't really that interested in coming over here and trying to cramp white's style. Black's not really interested in just defending the corner. Maybe black doesn't want to invade yet. What do you think black wants to do in this type of situation? I can put some more stones out if it helps you visualize. I need 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, yep. So black's move.
Oh,
if we want to do something with this group.
Oh,
say it again?
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought we were focusing on the bottom.
Oh, we're focusing on, let's say, this half of the board.
Oh, okay.
Because, I mean, we can say we should come over here. All right, let's play this out. Oops, that's not the right color. Let's do this thing again. Let's say for some reason white plays. Okay, good. Black move.
17-9.
Extend our base this way.
Oh, actually not 10.
17-10, so sort of develop this. I think this is okay. But I want again, the lecture today is called Two Space Base.
Well, the idea here was to prevent white from making two space.
Prevent white from coming over here and making a base.
This move is okay.
But I want to...
You're looking at, like, 9-3.
I'm looking at 9-3. This move is potentially really good if we want to fight. All right, we're going to come right in here and try to squash this. I'm going to say this might be a hair better, actually. It's the shape. But for right now, I'm going to veto this. I'm going to say we're not looking at fighting. We're just looking at trying to make this bigger. I want to develop this, help this... and make white pee his pants a little bit at the immense size of our potential.
17-12 maybe?
17-12 right here?
Yeah. Or maybe one more, maybe 17-11.
No. All right, good. I'm just going to tell you the answer.
Down the bottom.
I expect that actually I'm you know, with so many newer players here, a lot of you guys have never seen moves like this before. So this is going to be out of this world today, I think, for you guys.
13-4.
I'm looking at this one.
12.
Is that close to
it? It's off by one.
Oh, you're thinking here?
Yeah, and mine looked too close.
Yeah, so this is a far out move, right? This isn't on any of your radars except for Judy's, but she doesn't count.
That's crazy.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's crazy talk. Why is this move crazy?
Presses
white. It seems like white
can
just kind of isolate it.
Yeah. White can isolate it?
Yeah.
How do you want to isolate
start
it?
Start running down to be able to cut off. Start running down towards.
Do you want to come this way?
Yeah.
Oh, you have no more base white. Now we fight. I just ruined your base. How does this white stone feel?
Sad.
Really sad. All right, and you think, oh, I'm going to attack you, black. You can't attack this black. It's too far out. Like, we have a weak white group and a weakish black group, but another weakish white group. I mean, this should be a good fight for black, right?
No kidding.
Right, strong black, weak white, weakish black, weakish white.
And also,
if you add up the pluses
and
the minuses.
Ahead. Black's ahead of those guys on the left.
Yeah, black's ahead, right?
Of the guys on the left. For now. He's ahead of only of those, but
it's white's move though. It's white's move. We don't. You know, can't say it defiantly. This is a good fight. This is a really good fight for black. Like if this happens in the game, and you're black, you should be ecstatic.
Smiling.
Because what did white have before this whole thing started? Solid base. Bases are good because once you have a solid base, you can play crazier moves. Right, you can do daring invasions. You can invade deeply. You can fight things that you shouldn't be able to fight over if you have strong bases. If you don't have a strong base and all of your groups are just running around the board, things are going to go poorly. Yeah, there's already shape problems. All right, so we're going to go back. All right, so this idea, this was a good in spirit move, but terrible idea in practice.
Yeah.
Right. Often you never want to let your opponent like get what they want. But there's always times when this is appropriate and even the correct move. But this is like, oh yeah, we're gonna throw down! This is crazy talk, okay? So what would you normally do if black played here and you were white?
13-12.
Yeah, you normally play here, right?
Yeah.
Say, oh, I have a base. And you can actually say, thank you, black. Look, I didn't know if my base was really solid here. After black plays here and white plays here, this is really hard to now for black to do anything in here, right? Like this is very difficult. And meanwhile, how does this stone look?
Sad. Pretty sad.
It's pretty sad. Like it has a friend over here,
but it's
surrounded by white nearby. So we need another move for black.
So if black started bringing 3-3. Yeah, black started bringing the black stone back to the corner, he's not really fencing up the Moyo, though.
Well, we'll see. All right, so here, we have a selection for 13-3. This is a little too aggressive again.
13-4.
This one, I don't think it's going to work out very well.
No.
Because it turns out white can just cut here and capture it with any of these moves.
Yeah.
These two stones just get trapped on the inside. So...
Wait, I guess 13-4 is what I...
Oh, here?
Yeah.
Close, very close.
Okay. Oh, there's 9?
14.
This one. This is the normal follow-up. And so, I know it's white's move, so white will respond to this. But as of this moment, how does our dream look?
It's looking bigger.
Yeah, we're actually kind of accomplishing something. And before, we were worried about this move for white, right? Because if white plays here, we'd have to play here to prevent white from taking away our base.
Okay.
Not this time.
But...
Why am I not worried about white poking at this?
Because we're out.
Because we're already out here. Like, even though we might not have two eyes guaranteed here, We have stones all the way up here, and these are all going to be very, very useful for us. So we're not. White doesn't really have time to come over here and do this sort of shenanigan. So we can attack anything over here very, very strongly. Just say, oh, you want to come here? No base for you. Right, force him on the run. And maybe white jumps out, and you go, no running for you. And we just sort of direct white into our giant little fishing net. Maybe across this way, where we just make a million points. All sorts of fun we're going to have.
Well, what if white's first move in there was basically on the 17-3 there, down in the middle of it, right below the starting point, yeah, right there. But if white first moved in there, black approaches on one side, right?
I think so. I think we go this way.
Yeah. And if black goes that side, then white jumps up on the other side.
Okay.
And will two spaces be good enough? No. Okay. But what I was thinking is, this a way for back? Is this a way for white to essentially get back up to the point where he might?
Yeah, but I'm still not going to respond over here.
Okay.
Right. I still have this. It doesn't change anything. I still attack it.
Because you still have. You're still.
I still have all this. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I got you.
So. Instead of coming here right away, white usually tries to disrupt this a little bit, especially because if black gets another move, there's actually a shape problem for white. Let's say white plays this. Don't ever play that. This is the rule. There's this shape problem. There's Atari, you know, potential. So white, we'll need to play another move over here. And meanwhile, black will get this very solid-looking wall. There's no more holes in it. Well, one more hole, but it's not... You can deal with one hole. Two holes are a problem. So usually, in this case, white will poke at the first hole. But this is not a big deal. Because at this point, black might even say, you know what, I want more. And black's willing to even trash these stones. But they're actually going to help. If white comes up through here, these are still useful stones. Even though white can just capture them, be like, I want that stone. Black's like, you know what, kid? That's great. You can have that stone. I'm just going to continue building this. So, if black really, really wanted to make this thicker,
we can. White has gotten so solid.
Yeah, this is very solid.
You better be able to do something. Now the onus
look at my potential.
Now the onus is on black. Not only
what?
To
how
be
is the
safe? He's got to actually do something.
Does black have to do anything? Well, look at this potential for black. Black has all the potential. It's white who needs to do something. Mm-hmm. The onus is on white.
If white
does nothing, black wins by a million points.
Oh,
if the colors were reversed, I had black. I'd be very worried about this.
Why would you be worried?
It just seems to be the kind of position I get into where I got some stuff on the side and my opponent has four.
Well,
that's why.
Now we need to work on your attacking. Yeah. But black should not be worried. Here. Black is fine.
Okay,
so here, let's go through this pattern again. Let's go back. Because this pattern is very, very common, okay, in this type of situation.
Okay, let's see the pattern.
All right. Yes. Do you guys think you all can get to this Joseki?
Yes.
All right, so black wants to build the middle. What's the move for black to play?
Attack white on the 7.
Yeah, we're gonna lean on white, right? Every move and go, you know, sometimes, you know, it feels like your stone's only doing one thing, even when sometimes they're actually doing like 2, 3, 4 things. We really want to build over here, right? So you guys really want to play stuff like this to build over here. I don't want to build over here this way. This is very inefficient for, you know, stronger level play. I want to build over here by just pressing down on white over here. And that actually gives me a lot more control over this area because that helps this group, extends the influence outward, and even gives me a little bit of like a fishing net over here I can run my opponent into. So this is the move. What does white normally do?
12-3.
What does black do to...
14-4.
Yeah, now we come back. And then white move. Poke at which hole?
13-4.
13-4, black?
13-4.
5. Target's free. White.
Fixes.
Yeah, usually fixes.
Why not do 14-5 instead for white?
14-5 here?
Tari. Yeah.
Oh. You play such dangerous go.
And then 15-4.
Oh, gosh. Uh-huh.
Oh, okay, I see. Yes.
And then what?
Never mind.
You're going to go here?
Never
mind. This is double Atari, or Atari, wait for it. Atari, capture that one. What? Oh gosh. That's not a pattern. You did not learn that from me. If you play that in your game, you say you did not attend this class.
I have a reputation.
At this point, black will usually play somewhere else. So black can take another big point here, or you know, maybe thinking about doing something over here, but I don't know, I like that.
Not on the right side.
Not over here?
No,
that's why I played all these moves, so I don't have to play over here.
Okay.
So it's sort of like the effect is black's got some weak stones there, and if white attacks them, the effect is like to capitulate black into the area you really want us to be in.
These are like stones I want to give up.
Yeah.
Like, this is the bait, right? I'm putting a bunch of weak stones here,
yeah,
so I can get a bunch of free moves here. And if white never takes these stones, at some point, they'll become really strong. I can go back and fix them. So it's sort of like, you know, this is like the piece of meat you feed the tiger, just to keep the tiger happy. But meanwhile, you're constructing the big cage that the tiger is never really aware of.
Well, I'm comfortable with using bait, but this seems like excessive chumming.
It seems like what?
Excessive chumming.
Excessive chumming.
No, it's great. It's great. This is really normal. Like you know, leaving groups of weak stones that you kind of want your opponent to attack because your opponent can't really profit. The profit that your opponent would get from attacking is very small. So that's very efficient. You can play weak stones that your opponent can't attack because it's too small. That's really efficient go play. Okay, so do you guys have this pattern?
Mm-hmm.
Good. All right, let's change up the board a little bit. We're going to look at something of a more theoretical position. Probably partially. Let's say it looks like this. It's on this side of the board. So what does white have?
Space.
Two space. However, this two space space is not very strong. Why? I mean, two space bases are great, right? It's a way to make eyes. Why? How can I call this not very strong?
He's got black on the other side of here.
Yeah, there's black here and there's black here. Basically, just pinching you in.
No eyes.
And they're, well, right now, well, it depends who gets the player first.
Half of some.
But as black, there's a whole bunch of wonderful, mean, terrible things we can do to this unfortunate two-faced guy. All right, you want to see, like, the least severe first or the most severe?
Let's go with the most.
All right, probably the two most severe moves are here or here. And this is the type of move you play when you want to say, no eyes for you. You have to be strong on the outside in order to justify these moves. If there's a bunch of white friends out here, this is terrible. Don't do this. Okay? Because white will just get strong out here and just run out and connect, and you'll gain like 2 points. You're not worth it. If white's stronger on the outside, then we'll play one of these other moves from this side. Okay? But if you need white to run, if you say, you know what? The way I'm going to win this game is by attacking and harassing this group all around the board. I need to pop out the eyes. There's two weak points here and here. All right, let's try one of them. We can do this one first. How do you think white responds?
Seems like the obvious thing to do would be try to capture that black stone.
Let's try it.
Yeah.
Let's kill it. Yeah, there's actually two good responses. They're actually very similar, but there are slight differences that aren't that important, actually, for most, you know, 80% of the time. We can fight right here. This is a weird-looking move. If you'd never seen this move before and you were white, what would you try to do at this point?
A2.
Yeah, you'd be like, let's play here. That seems smart. Let's capture the whole thing. That's like a lot of food. Well-fed tiger. What do we do as black?
10-2. Attack.
You play your secret weapon. If white tries to cut us off, we just solidify our shape and poke right through. If white says, you can't come through there, that's mine. White's kind of an asshole. What do we do?
D3.
Yeah, there's actually several variations depending on how violent we want to be. But probably the easiest and safest is to take this Atari.
7-2.
And at this point, we could even just play moves like this. Just help out the corner. If we really want to be safe, we could play there and just capture that stone. But even if we just play, you know, basically anything, white can't actually capture this because the stone is going to die before we do. So that's pretty terrifying for white. How many eyes does white have?
None.
Yeah. So, you know, even if we just take this, play very simply, white can get a free Atari. Now, white has no eyes, it basically has to run out. And as long as I said, remember I said this whole thing rested on whether or not white has friends over here to run to? If white has no friends to run through, how is this going to go for black?
Incredibly well.
If white does have, like, a friend right here,
not so much.
Yeah, you're like, ah, gain 2 points. We got that. That probably wasn't the biggest move on the board. Okay? Do you want to see this pattern again? No?
More violent variation.
More violent variation. That was a pretty violent variation, actually. You guys said you wanted the violent one first. Let's do the same. Violent variation. Let's play a different variation, a version of it. Instead of white coming down, I'm just trying to trap on the inside. Let's say white comes across. Now, what does black do?
Oh,
where?
10-3.
Which one?
10-3.
10-3.
Moon splitting.
All right. This is possible, but not if you want to remove white's eyes. This is actually changing your direction. Like this is the type of move you play when you decide, you know what, I'm okay with white living, I just want the outside again. And I'll show you why. See if I can remember what. I think we play here. We play here. White just fixes. If we're really dire, white can just take, actually, at this point. But white can also just fix. And if black runs, white can actually capture this. Black cuts, white Ataris, black Ataris, white takes, black takes the outside. So, yes, this is a variation, not the one I intentionally wanted to show you today. But this is like the change your mind variation about what you want. This is the, oh right, that thing white was gonna get a base there that I was gonna take away, oh, he can have it again. Let's not play that one.
Okay.
All right, so we played there. So what's another option? The change your mind variations here. I'm gonna suggest you don't even memorize that. You erase that previous, you know, 90 seconds from your brain.
12-2?
Oh, there's better. 10-2, nice. This is a better move. It actually accomplishes the same thing as 12-2. Peter, what's your idea going to 12-2?
Well, it connects out.
Yeah, it connects out. But white's gonna get this for free and start to actually develop eye potential again. And what was our goal?
No eyes.
We don't like white having eyes. If we decide you have to block here, this is a lot of my potential. I'm not gonna lie. Like, if we give any white any of the free moves, it's like there's ice. So, the other key move is where? This one. And then, this actually still connects out. Right? If white blocks you over here, nothing has changed. We still get out. And if white blocks on this side, that also gets out. And there's still this defect here. So black can actually choose to push and cut or just come out and then decide how to use this defect later.
You're letting white decide how he wants to hang himself.
That's a little bit, yeah. Well, you're keeping your options open, right? You're saying, okay, white, how do you want to make your eyes? And if white tries to make an eye right there, you just poke it. And if white doesn't, you keep the liberty for later. This is like many years ago now, I guess. I don't know how many years, maybe 4 or 5 years ago. At the US Go Congress every year, there's a tournament called the Ing Masters, where they invite like 32 of the strongest players there to play in a tournament. And one year, they introduced a new rule that basically disqualified a lot of the top people. And so I got to play in it. And my first game was against Curtis Tang, who was for like 3 years in a row like the strongest kid in the United States or Canada, or just like North America, basically the strongest under 18 player in the North America. And that was my first game. And it was actually a game that was very meaningful for me. Partially because after the game, Curtis was like, I was going to lose that game. Because I had taken outside, I had played very consistently, and by entering the middle game, I had this really giant outside formation. I just had everything everywhere. And, this insanely strong player, went in here and invaded and basically made this two-space base. And I played here. And the next 50 moves of the game was basically him trying to find two eyes. Actually, probably more than 50 moves. And then I eventually made a mistake somewhere in one of this whole thing is like running everywhere, right? And can't get eyes. And finally I make some mistake somewhere in the middle on some ladder read. And he gets out and I have to resign because that's the whole game. But, so anyway, this is an important shape. He was convinced that he was going to have to resign after, after like 20 moves of this. Of him just running around not being successful. Okay. So, variation, why does this work?
Strong.
Yeah, black has, especially if black has another stone over here. Oh yeah, this is feel good time, go right in. Because if this runs, you're just gonna get a bunch of free moves here and make this all into points. You might get a bunch of free moves here and make this into points, it's great.
Okay.
Slightly different scenario. Let's move some stones around. How do I wanna do this today? This is all right. So this is a pretty different. Do I have an appropriate number of stones per board? I do not. White needs like two more. Okay. It's quite the corner. two space base.
White's paranoid.
Yeah. Okay. Here's the situation. Something similar. You get the idea, right? You appreciate this. What do we want to do here?
You don't want white to run out because it's got all those white stones in the corner.
Well, they're far away, though. How do we want to take advantage of, or how do we want to pressure this two-space base? Like, two-space, it's a base, right? White has potential. But black's going to ask, a few questions about where that potential exactly is. What direction should we ask those questions from?
Away from white
oil.
Yeah, wouldn't it be great if we could seal this thing in somehow? Like, wouldn't that just be awesome?
Yes.
Because look at this. And especially if we can seal it in Sente. Like, maybe we get a wall here, and come back and shoulder hit here, and make this giant thing, and then you can almost scare Curtis Tang, you know, into resigning. Like, wouldn't that be great? So how do we do that?
Like 10-4 or
something? 10-4? Nice move. This is a really nice move. Pro level. 9 on pro level move.
Yes! I have moments of inspiration.
It's glorious. Alright, what do you think white will want to do? Yeah, I mean, we have to guard our base, right? We don't want to run around this giant black thing. So let's just defend. Can you go 2 in a row?
12-4 then.
Nice move.
It feels like the previous one where we were talking about
base. It's very similar, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, go patterns or patterns. I mean, that's... Yeah, it turns out humans are pretty good at pattern recognition. All right, what do you think white does?
Peace.
Resigns.
Resigns.
11-4.
11-4, yeah, this is most normal. You guys are playing the most normal moves here. So far, you're like 3 out of 3. Do I dare to keep going, or should we quit right now?
Black respond at 11-5?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. All right, is that 4 in a row?
Yeah.
5 in a row. 5 in a row. Let's go for 6.
White fills.
All right, this one...
Not so sure.
All right, come on, help me out. We can go 7 out of 7. There might be more dissent, though, among the crowd.
Now 9-16.
9-16. Over here?
Over here?
Not yet. Not yet. Which one? Say it again. 10-5. This one. Yeah, are you happy if white comes through here?
No.
The strong group.
But do you want it to help the other?
I was thinking 13-4.
Yeah. This is the move. This is a nice move. Now, in this case, actually, maybe I should move the black stone right back there, right? Sorry about it.
So if white tries to attack at 10-5.
Yeah, and this is especially at this point, white really only has one guaranteed eye over here.
Yeah. But if white decides to attack that stone, black comes down and says, fine, I got half the board.
Yes, which move?
I think straight down.
Nice move. This is a Joseki.
This is Joseki.
If white needs to guarantee himself another eye, this is most normal. And usually white will actually play one more move if white wants to be completely guaranteed alive. Because this actually isn't guaranteed alive, right? There's actually the possibility that black can run this out or falsify this eye.
Yeah. So, pop one more.
9-5.
9-5 is a nice move. That's the Joseki. This is a very, very common pattern in black. You know, has a little bit of pressure on this base. Maybe not as severe as pressure. Like before, we had like really severe pressure and we had all the outside influence. But we have a fair bit of pressure, but we definitely have a direction. We want to play. We definitely want to build something this way. If black built something this way, like a giant wall here, that would have been like, you screwed up. That would have been a failure. Why would a black wall here be useless?
Potential is too small.
Yeah, look at all these white stones over here. What is black going to build that's really big potential? There is no potential there. White has this really solid base, so you want to build a potential over here. And now, if white tries to invade over here, not a good invasion. Oh, I don't know. Take a move. I don't even know what the right move is, actually. I've never been so happy about this invasion.
13-7.
Pick one. There's nowhere for this white group to go, right? It basically has to try to find eyes somewhere here, and it's going to have a rough time.
Maybe that.
I don't know. Do you want to attack this?
Sure.
It looks it's under attack. I don't know.
It looks like a lot of moves might work. Might kill it. It might actually kill it with a lot of moves.
This is really menacing for any white stones over here. This is like a whole part of the board it can't run to. It can only run this way, and you can try to squirm over here. That's it.
I mean,
all right, let's see this variation again. Let's practice the variation. All right, what does black do?
10-4.
10-4.
Okay, white?
10-3.
12-4.
12-4. 11.
11-4.
13-4.
Good. If white continues locally?
10-5.
Good.
11-6.
9-5.
There you go. Nice. Strosecki. There is a very new variation that I've seen a couple of pro players play very recently that I will show you that what pro players tend to do with a lot of these types of variations is that they, you know, they sort of play out this like standard set, and then they'll take away the unnecessary moves and they'll play like almost this abbreviated version of it. Well, they'll leave the shape mostly basically still in the same shape, but with like some flexibility still left in it somehow. And I'll show you the more modern variation, even though I haven't played it myself ever, I don't think. So it's the same. And instead of playing, actually this would occur in this situation. Instead of playing here, you just play here. And the effect, if white keeps playing locally, the end result is pretty similar. But the problem is that there's actually a lot more variations in this one because white has more room here. So there's more things, variations that are still unexplored. Like this is more modern. This is very recent type of formation. Okay, but the one I want you to know, right, is when you have a stone here, you play there, you pull back.
So is it significant that we're playing on the 10 column because there's a one space on the right and two spaces on the left?
Yes, we wouldn't necessarily want to play this way. All right, we're gonna because we're planning on coming back here and linking up, we're gonna play as far as we can. If we play here, it's sort of like, well, now are we gonna come back? And if we do, this is actually a really nice shape for white, as we're basically in the middle and we have lots of white space still. And we actually still have a defect. Black still needs to come back and fix this defect somehow. So that spot makes a big difference. All right, let's look at another situation. Okay. So here's 1, 2, 3. Can I move skis? Fair fight. Okay, good. What do we do here, Black?
We have no base in the left corner.
We don't really have a base in that corner.
So we want to attack white and make a base.
Okay, how do we do that?
Maybe 7-3.
Yeah,
I like this move. I'd like it actually more if this white stone wasn't here. I'd like it a lot more. This is okay. This is okay.
Would this invite white to go to like 14-4? Or do you mean 14 or 15?
Yeah, it can. Okay. Absolutely, yeah. Right? Because we saw that this would be really severe against the group, against the two-space base, right? So yeah, if white doesn't want to deal with that, white can just play here.
Yeah.
This is very normal. Like this is a very normal type of continuation. Mm-hmm. I'm not actually sure this is 100% correct, though. Again, we're still actually very interested in developing this side. So I'm probably more interested in playing this way. All right, so now what does white do?
Extend the other
way. Yeah, we can still go this way. And in this case, I'll show you a couple things. I'm not saying these are like actual Joseki, but these are common moves you'll see. You might see black play moves like here. This is it's often played as a ladder breaker. But it does give up a lot of Aji because you are removing some other invasions later. But you might play something like this to say, hey, white, what do you care about? White says, I want to keep those strong. You can play here and get another free move. You're probably there. And now maybe we come back and we play a move like this. And we just build the corner. That's a possibility. But the idea is that, you know, all of our moves were sort of natural, right? Black wants to build the bottom, so black's going to go this way. White's going to then go on the corner. We're now worried about our corner. We might try to take any sort of free stuff we have and then just sort of, you know, defend our corner. This is go. Like, this is how you play go, right? But it's both players sort of deciding, okay, how do I want to deal with that two-space base? Is it really strong? Do I need to extend it again? You know, how do I prevent it from being attacked? How do I prevent it from being surrounded? And there are these natural repercussions that follow. So, you know, at this point in the game, this is a really big decision for black, right? Because whichever way black pushes, it's going to determine quite a bit of the shapes for the rest of the game. I mean, this is like, you know, the amazing thing about Go is, you know, as me, if I was playing black right here, I'm very aware of, like, you know, two different realities sort of break off. If I push this way, the game's going to look that way, right? If I play this way, we're going to play an entirely different game down here. It's going to look very, very different. Here's another common situation. There is no two-space base.
So black's going to tell white where they're going to create their two-space.
Absolutely. That's exactly what's going to happen. We have the same kind of situation. Do we want to tell white to make it over here? Or do we want to tell white to make it over there? And sometimes it's better to actually just play a move like this, where you're saying, you don't have quite enough room to make a really clear two-space base over here. Do you want one right now? Like, you know, there's a little bit of room for you, but, you know, let's be reasonable. This is not a two-space base. And so white still might come back over here. And this type of thing is very, very common. Where you don't necessarily make, this is called a checking extension, where you don't make the full checking extension, but you play a more defensive type of extension, which still will guide white this way. And if white comes over here, now you come back and take your corner and make this nice shamari. And this would be a nice development for black. Or, you know, you can just go, like, you know, just waving your Molotov cocktail and just go that way! You don't have to do this subtly, just saying, you're going that way! All right, and then we get something like this. At this point, if white doesn't want to deal with this, white might come out. Come over here. And now white's thinking about these sort of follow-ups in the corner here, maybe here. Try to counterattack that stone. This is go. This is like these sort of skirmishes that can come out after these two-space base kind of positions, which are kind of cool. All right, actually, speaking of this, this is another common formation. You see, I'm going to give black a stone. Let's make black a stone there, I guess. What if white has this? How does black harass this thing?
Take the fourth corner.
Yeah, this is kind of a key point, actually. And it's actually very awkward for white, surprisingly awkward for white to get eyes. I mean, white has to play a move like this if white wants to have no Aji in here to be really clean. But this is actually really, first of all, this is kind of silly looking. And second, this is a good exchange for black, right? Black has to play another stone on the outside. If white doesn't play this, white's not going to do that. What would you want to have white do? All right. Well, here, let's say white goes and says,
"White can make another move." No.
Okay. So all right. Let's say white plays there. All right. Black plays here.
All right. I'm solid.
Are you going to connect?
Yeah.
This is the move.
Okay.
Again, right? We've seen this key point before, right? So, what's the fate of this stone?
Not sure.
Yeah, it's basically dead.
It's cooked.
All right. Well, neat. And there are even cases when white has this kind of formation. If you're strong enough, you don't have to play this the fourth corner. You can actually come right here and peek first. with something else to look at.
But look what's going to happen.
Yeah, this can be very dangerous though, right?
Well, say you just connect.
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. What do you got?
I took away the base.
You didn't
really
big on that.
That's
stupid. <You're laughs> That's amazing.
All right, well, I mean... Yeah. Sure, and I'm all right. But I'm looking.
What, if your opponent has a base of stones, what do you want to do to it?
But I'm looking at. I mean, you're looking at.
You either want to steal it or take away the base, right?
Right.
Okay.
But sure, you took away his base, but yeah, you took away his eye shape. But
that's the definition of a base.
But look how solid you. Look how solid these stones can be made.
What, white stones are going to be solid?
They can be made really solid.
Solid with or
yeah,
without
and, eyes. And black, no, and everybody knows it.
With or without
eyes. Look at the push through by black, by white. Right. Sure.
Now,
this is not good.
Okay, cut.
Here.
Right, and you can squeeze.
Yeah, you can squeeze.
Sorry?
Yeah, do you have any eyes yet?
Squeeze you.
Sure, do you have any eyes yet?
I want to crudely squeeze.
You want to go here?
Yeah.
Then?
I'm more squeezing.
More this
thank
way?
You. Yeah, sure. I can go more.
This is terrible.
This is terrible.
Where do you go next?
I can squeeze more.
This one?
I got a solid thing.
Okay.
And who says I played this first?
Okay.
Who says I didn't prepare this?
So, all right, you get one more move there.
But I can do this any time. I mean,
sure.
a lot of times.
Sure. I'm just saying, we only play this crazy move when we don't want white to have a base. Does white have a base?
White does not have a base, but white is...
I'm not going to play this move unless I'm strong on the outside,
sure.
and white doesn't have any friends. If white doesn't have any friends, there's no eyes here.
Sure.
Okay. I mean, there's reputations. I mean, white can get it.
Okay.
But we just got punch of profit, and white doesn't have any eyes. I think we did okay. Okay. So, what do we learn about the two-space base? It's thumbs up. It's two thumbs up.
And there are terrifying moves you can do against it.
There are terrifying things you can do to it, but what do they usually require?
A favorable
context. Here, if let's play give and go. Alright, white plays here, black plays there. White plays here, black plays here. Two space base. First question.
Does black win?
Does black win?
No.
This is actually not very good play. We usually make the two space base when we're in a defensive posture, right? When we're inside our opponent's sphere. Can white attack this?
Yes.
No.
Slowly.
Not really.
No.
Not at all.
Yeah, why? What's the difference?
Because he's open.
It's
a tag.
Yeah, there's no friends here.
If he attempts to attack it, then he'll be the one making slow moves.
So white can attack, but black
sure,
can attack.
Down.
It's like,
please
white,
attack them.
White plays here?
Yeah.
And on the other down. Side. Then black counter. Did he squeeze him?
Yes, Dan.
Okay, and then white's attacking on the other side, otherwise it's not an attack, right?
Right, white has to play over here.
Right, now...
I think you're going to have to sit up, Dan, to see this bottom row.
Yeah. This is not good.
So, yeah.
Black just eats. So a two-space base, again, by itself, there's nothing around it. It's really strong. That's really, really strong. In order for white to attack this, what types of things does white need? Yes, yeah, so like how about a stone here? Let's put a stone there. Oh, that stone would be great if we have a stone there. Or not even better if we have a stone over here. This would be great. Okay, now we can attack this thing.
At this point, give it
all you need is for black to let white make four moves in a row.
That's right. So, I mean, we make a big deal about having a two-space base, right? If you guys watch any of the pro reviews we've done or the game commentaries, even your own review, like, we make a big deal of it. And some students are like, why? Why do we need a two-space base? Well, because that gives you eye potential. It gives you strong friends with eye potential in your opponent's neck of the woods, okay? But if your opponent is strong enough, that still doesn't guarantee you anything. Okay? So there's a very big difference between this and this. Okay? And this, we don't want to play a two-space base. In fact, we want to go do something much more active, cover more turf. Okay, so you guys got some good variations. You guys want to take a minute to practice them here? Maybe try to recall them on the board?
Sure.
All right. Good. Well, thank you.